Fellowship Pickering. I'm Erica.
And this is Maron. Welcome to our online church. We hope to see you on Sunday at the park.
Now let's worship God together!
What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong. Who holds our days within His hand? What comes apart from His command? And what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand.
Hallelujah, now and ever we
trace nor stain of sin. See the true and better Adam come to save a hell-bound man. Christ the great and sure fulfillment of the law.
Good morning, church. I hope you've had a great week. Listen, today I want to speak to you on this subject, the presence of God. You know, there is so much comfort in just being in the presence of people that we love, is there not? When I was younger, I used to look at silence as the great enemy. I used to think that if there was any kind of silent space that it needed to be filled with words. Sounds like a true extrovert, right? God made us to talk after all, and when it's nobody is, then I'll do that. But, you know, the fact of the matter is the older I'm getting, the more I appreciate just being in the presence of my loved ones in silence. You know, just to sit with my wife, Erica, in the mornings as we drink a cup of coffee or tea and read the Word of God, just to be in her presence, to watch a television show, or if she's reading something as I'm reading something, just to look over at her and see her, just to be in the presence of my wife is a great, great gift from God. Just to be in the presence of my kids as they learn the rules of a new board game and begin to play with one another, just to be in their presence and just to observe them. It's such a gift. I get so much joy, so much satisfaction in just being in the presence of my loved ones. You know, last week I was listening to a sermon while I was at the gym. I do that often. I want to encourage you to do that. Reach out to me if you want some good sources of preachers that are sound doctrinally and all those kinds of things. But I was listening to a sermon from one of my favorite preachers last week in the gym. And this preacher told a story from the Bible that I knew that I was familiar with, but I hadn't studied it in depth in a good while. And the story was in Exodus chapter 33. About Moses and the tent of meeting that he established. And he established this tent in order to get into the presence of God, to speak to God, to hear from him, to seek his face, to learn more about his nature and character. And this preacher said that Moses knew all about the ways of God. He knew all about the miracles of God. After all, Moses had seen Jehovah God send the plagues to Pharaoh in Egypt, and so that the Israelites could be set free from the oppressive bondage of the Egyptian ruler. He had seen the plagues. Moses had seen the ways of God and how he parted the Red Sea so that they could escape from the Egyptians who were chasing after them. Like Moses had seen, he knew all about the ways of God. He knew all about the power of God. This preacher kept on talking about how Moses knew about the ways of God, but Moses wanted to be in the presence of God. Moses knew about the ways of God, but he wanted to know about the character of God. He wanted to be in the presence of God. And that word has just so resonated in my heart ever since I heard it. Because I long to be in the presence of God. I know what our God can do. I know he is a miracle worker. I've seen him heal people of cancer. I've seen him reconcile husbands and wives whom had had adulterous affairs, and God healed their marriage. I've seen God do so many amazing, incredible things. I know about the ways of God, but I want to be more in the presence of God. And this morning, I want to take us on a journey into this story, and I want us to see what happens when we prioritize time with God in our lives. What happens when we prioritize seeking the presence of God, getting into the presence of God? What could happen in our lives? I just want to pull out some principles from this story and share with you today. First, I want to give you a bit of a historical background into this text, to really what's taking place. We're going to start with Exodus chapter 33, verses 1 through 3. God's word says this: "Then the Lord spoke to Moses, 'Depart, go up from here, you and the people whom you have brought up from the land of Egypt, to the land of which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying to your descendants, I will give it. I will send an angel before you, and I will drive out the Canaanite, the Amorite, the Hittite, the Perizzite, the Hivite, and the Jebusite,'" all the sites, all the heights, "'go up to a land flowing with milk and honey, for I will not go up in your midst, because you are an obstinate people, and I might destroy you along the way.'" Now, just a bit of a background. If you remember how God had freed the Israelites, his people, from the oppressive hand of Pharaoh, and they're wandering now in the wilderness. Do you remember when Moses went to go get the Ten Commandments, and the Israelites there, they built a golden calf, and they were worshiping him as this idol? Remember this story? This is what God's talking about in this passage, and this is what he's saying to Moses. He's saying, you are an obstinate, stiff-necked, in some translations, people. You don't listen to what I say. You disobey me. These people have no regard for my regulations and my rules. He says, I will not go up into your midst. He says, I'll give you the promised land, but I will not go up in your midst. God says, my immediate presence will not be with you. One commentator writes this, and I quote, "We might say that God said, I won't stay so close to you because I might judge you along the way, but go on and take the promised land." This is a challenge to Moses and the nation as a whole. God is telling them that they could have the promised land, but he would not remain with them in a close, intimate, personal way. And if they were satisfied with that arrangement, it would prove that they only loved God's blessings and not God himself. Whoa, that's getting close to my toes this morning. Because too often, I just want God's blessing, but I don't want God. He says if they challenged God, though, if if they pleaded with him for his presence, if they begged him for his presence, not only his blessings, that it would show a genuine love and heart, not for God's stuff, not for God's gifts, but for God himself. This was the first step towards spiritual restoration and revival in Israel. And now the question is this, what are the people going to do? Are they going to say, you know what, God, I mean, the promised land is ours. You said we can have it. I mean, that's really all we were in this thing for. We're good. Or are they going to say, we repent, we lament, we are broken, we mourn because of our sin and disregard to only desire what you can give to us and not to desire you? How are they going to react? Look at verses 4 through 6 in Exodus 33 to see how they respond. When the people heard this sad word, they went into mourning, and none of them put on his ornaments. Ornaments would have been bracelets or attire to make them look fashionable or presentable. For the Lord had said to Moses, "Say to the sons of Israel, you are an obstinate people. Should I go up in your midst for one moment, I would destroy you. Now therefore, put off your ornaments from you, that I may know what I shall do with you." So the sons of Israel stripped themselves of their ornaments from Mount Horeb onward. The Bible says that they mourned, and no one put on his ornaments. This is a good response on behalf of Israel. To them, it was bad news that God's immediate personalized presence was not going to be with them. They mourned the potential loss of that presence from God. It shows that they cared about the relationship with the Lord. They cared about that intimacy and not just what he could give to them. And let me just stop you right now and ask a question. Do you care more about what the Lord can give to you than his presence with you? You know, on Wednesday nights, we gather together as a church and we pray. And we've been learning how to pray through scripture. And it has been so profound to understand that it is so important that we seek the face of God before we seek the hand of God. And let me articulate what that means very briefly. When we go into the presence of God and all we say is, God, give me, give me, give me, give me. God, I want, I want, I want, I want. And we don't just sit in his presence. We don't just worship who he is through his word. We have the temptation to fall into this relationship with God like these Israelites, where we only want God for what he can give to us, not just to be in the presence of God, but what his hand gives to us. We've been learning to seek the face of God before we seek the hand of God. Very simply put, we must worship God in his presence before we ask of God. They mourned and put on, and no one put on his ornaments. This is a great, great sign. They knew that this was not the time for wearing their ornaments, for decorating the external, you know, trying to look the part, trying to look good, but it was time to make the heart right with God. It was time to mourn, to repent, to confess sin before a holy, perfect, righteous, just God. And this was the second step towards restoration and revival. So Moses sees the people's response. He decides that more so now than ever before, for himself, for his people, for the glory of God, he needed to be in the presence of God. And so what does he do? Exodus 33, verses 7 through 10 says this. Now Moses used to take the tent, and he pitched it outside the camp, a good distance from the camp, and he called it the tent of meeting. And everyone who sought the Lord would go out to the tent of meeting, which was outside the camp. And it came about, whenever Moses went out to the tent, that all the people would arise and stand, each at the entrance of the tent, and gaze after Moses until he entered the tent. Whatever Moses enter the tent, the pillar of cloud would descend and stand at the entrance of the tent, and the Lord would speak with Moses. When all the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the entrance of the tent, all the people would arise and worship each at the entrance of his tent. Moses says, these people, for the most part, I see that they're serious about their repentance. I'm going to set up this tent as a meeting place with God to get into the presence of God. And so I just want us to see some things that can happen in our lives from this text today when we decide, when we draw a line in the sand and say, we are going to get into the presence of God. Not every now and again, not when we feel like it, not when we don't feel like it. We're going to get into the presence of God daily. And I want us to see what can happen when we get into the presence of God. When you're in the presence of God, first of all, this morning, we get to know God intimately, and we will cause others to do the same. Look at Exodus 33, 11a. It says, so the Lord spoke to Moses face to face as a man speaks to his friend, and he would return to the camp. Moses is face to face with God. And the text says, as a man speaks to his friend. Now what does that mean exactly? Numbers chapter 12, verse 8, it says, with him I speak face to face, clearly and not in riddles. He sees the form of the Lord. And so Moses had not, and he could not, we need to understand this today, see the actual face of God the Father in his glory, okay? No one has seen the face of God the Father in full glory. The Bible tells us this in 1 John chapter 4, verse 12. He literally says, no one has seen God at any time. But what it does mean is that he is in this intimate relationship with God in this tent. It means that he is clearly in the presence of God, and the form of God is present in that tent in some way, somehow. It's possible that it meant that God appeared to Moses in human form as he did to Abraham in Genesis 18. But most likely, what face-to-face means here is a figurative expression, meaning openness and freedom and free fellowship with God the Father. And in other words, Moses had a real sense of freedom with God as he interacts with him in the tent. You know, oftentimes we get into the presence of God and we try to conceal, we try to hide. We don't sense a real intimacy with God. And in verses 12 through 13, it says, Moses said to the Lord, see, you say to me, bring up this people. In other words, God, you say to me, lead these people out of Egypt. You say to me, God, lead these people out of the wilderness and bondage and into the promised land. But you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Do you see the freedom in his conversation with God here? He's saying, God, you told me to do this, but I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know who's going to help me. Yet you have said, I know you by name, and you've also found grace in my sight. He says, I pray if I have found grace in your sight, show me now your way, that I may know you and that I may find grace in your sight, and consider this nation is your people. Oh, church, don't miss this. Do you see the intimacy here with God from Moses? He said, God, you said that I found grace in your sight. God, you say that I'm in relationship with you. Now, God, I'm asking you, show me your ways. And then look at the first half of verse 13. That I may know you. That I may know you. See, the goal of Moses here is not just to get answers. We're going to see that in a minute. It's not just to get answers from God for his life's problems, but it's actually to get to know God. He says that I may know you and that I may find grace in your sight. How do we find grace in the Father's sight? Well, for us, we in this new covenant, we have grace in the Father's sight through faith in His Son, Jesus Christ. There's this fancy word called justification, and now we are justified as we stand in the presence of God. Christ the Son took all of our sin and shame and guilt and put it on His back and went to a cross that you and I deserved, was crucified, and rose from the dead on the third day. This is how we have grace with the Father. Now, but Moses is praying, God, I want to know you. I want to have this grace that you talk about in your sight. And he says, consider that this nation is your people. In other words, show grace on your people as well, oh God. See, oftentimes when we get into the presence of God, we just want something, like I said just a moment ago. It's okay. God tells us to ask Him for things. God tells us to seek Him and we will find Him and all these things. But what if we just got into the presence of God to get to know God more intimately? Just to bask in His presence. And now watch this. When you get into the presence of God and seek Him and become more intimate with Him, watch what happens. Jump back up to the second half of verse 11. Exodus 33, 11b. It says, but His servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, did not depart from the tabernacle. Don't miss this. So as Moses is saying, I'm going to meet here until you talk with me, until we're face to face, until we have intimate relationship and fellowship, God, in your presence. As Moses says that, he's causing Joshua to do the same. Do you see that? He's causing Joshua to say, hold on, time out. If Moses is going to do that, I'm going to do that as well. Did you know that somebody's always watching you? You know, I talk to people and people say to me, well, I'm not really a leader. But did you know that essentially we're all leaders? Somebody's always watching you and watching your example. And when we seek the presence of God on a regular, consistent basis, did you know that that intimate walk with God will cause others to seek after God as well? It will cause our children and our spouses, maybe our unbelieving spouses, maybe unbelieving family members or friends or neighbors, but it causes others to start to ask questions. When you're in the presence of God, we get to know God intimately, and it will cause others to do the same. Secondly, this morning, when we're in the presence of God, we will recognize our helplessness apart from God. Our helplessness apart from God. Look at verses 14 through 16. And Moses said, God, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. Then he said to him, if your presence does not go with us, do not bring us up from here. Do not bring us up from here. For how then will it be known that your people and I have found grace in your sight, except you go with us? So we shall be separate, your people and I, from all the people who are upon the face of the earth. Oh, man, this is such a powerful word right here from Moses. I can just, in my mind, I can imagine him with tears rolling down his face. I'm not saying that's what happened. I'm not saying that's biblical. I'm not saying anything. And just my imagination and in my heart, I could imagine him having tears rolling down his face saying, God, if you don't go with us, if your presence is not with us, don't even bring us up from here. Don't even bring us up from here, God, because if you're not with us, then we are in trouble. What would happen today if we at Fellowship Pickering, what would happen today if all of God's people in the Big C, capital C church all around the world today would say what Moses says here? God, if you don't go with us, please don't send us. Holy Spirit of God, if you don't fill me and empower me as I try to raise godly kids up for your glory, I don't know. I can't do it. God, if you don't fill me and empower me and go with me as I seek to reach a lost world for your glory and honor, God, I can't do it. And you fill in the blank. with whatever God has called you to do. You know what one of our biggest problems is today in the church? We think that we can do so much apart from God. And he tells us in his word in John 15:5, that if we abide in the vine, we can bear much fruit for his glory. We could do many things, but apart from him, we can do nothing. Absolutely nothing. But you know what we've done? Church, we've fallen into this trap of believing like the world believes. We've fallen into this trap to thinking that we are smart enough, talented enough, good enough, sharp enough to come up with these plans and concoct these ideas and to try to get people into church and all these other kinds of things. And we need the heart of Moses. We must recognize our helplessness apart from God. We need God's presence. Moses was desperate for the presence of God. He says, so we shall be separate, your people and I, from all the people who are upon the face of the earth. Bit of a warning to us today that we have been called to be holy. God's people have been set apart for holiness. And the world says, I can rely on these methods. The world says I can rely on my gifts. The world says I can rely on my talents. The Bible says there's nothing good about us. The Bible says that we are depraved. The Bible says that our hearts are wicked. The Bible says that our hearts are sick. The Bible says that we are selfish. The Bible says that we pursue our desires over God's. The Bible says that there is nothing good within us. When you're in the presence of God, you recognize your helplessness apart from God. Thirdly, this morning, when you and I are in the presence of God, we receive answers from God. Look at verse 17. So the Lord said to Moses, I will also do this thing that you have spoken, for you have found grace in my sight, and I know you by name. In other words, God says, I'm going to answer your prayer, Moses. In other words, God says, I'm going to be with you. My presence is going to be with you. I'm going to walk with you and lead you and guide you and your people. You know, while we don't go into the presence of God just to get something from God, answered prayer is an amazing benefit of being in the presence of God. It absolutely boggles my mind over the years in the pastorate when I've asked people in the church, well, they'll say to me, Pastor, I'm going through this, and this is such a tough time. This is so hard, and I need wisdom for this, and I don't know what to do here. And I've been stuck like that before as well. And I'll ask them, I'll say, you know, have you taken this to the Lord? And they'll say, no, not really. Friends, it is such a temptation to try to get answers for the problems that present themselves in our lives. The Bible says that we are going to go through trials and tribulations. We're going to have difficulties in this world. Listen to me, church. It's promised to us. It's promised to us. And so what are we going to do when these trials come our way? Will we go to the world to try to find solutions to these problems or our inner wisdom that doesn't exist? Or are we going to go to God? And oftentimes we feel helpless and hopeless, as we just looked at, in our problems in our lives, because we don't know the solution. And we don't find the solution because we're not getting into the presence of God. But when you're in the presence of God, he will lead. He will give you that peace that surpasses all understanding and decision making and where we should be going and what we're supposed to be doing. And so when we're in the presence of God, thirdly this morning, we receive answers from God. You know, when we're in the presence of God, we get to know God intimately. When we're in the presence of God, we recognize our helplessness apart from God. When we're in the presence of God, we receive direction from God. But this last one that I want to share with you this morning, it's found in verse 18. And I actually think it's the most important reason why we must be in the presence of God. Moses said, "Please show me your glory. Please, God, show me your glory." You know, we live in a fallen world. We live in a world where sin runs rampant. We live in a world where our hearts, the pastor, preacher John Piper says, our hearts are idol factories. We can make an idol out of everything. We can make an idol out of our kids or our spouse or work or entertainment or TV or YouTube or Netflix or phones or whatever, sports. We can make idols out of everything because we live in a fallen world. As we begin to wrap up this morning, I just want to say this, church, like, what are you hungry for? What are you hungry for? See, when we're in the presence of God, we will hunger more for God. Do you know why we're not hungry for God? Do you know why we don't thirst and hunger for the righteousness of God? It's because we're not in the presence of God. Do you know why our mind is not filled with scripture and praise songs and hymns and sermons and prayers and all those things? You know why our mind is full of all these other, this other stuff? It's because we're saturating our minds. We're filling our minds with everything under the sun except for God. And therefore what? We're not hungering for God because we're not in the presence of God. We must hunger for God, but it's, here's the thing. It's not one of these things where we can say, okay, I'm going to hunger more for God. I'm just going to determine to hunger more for God. No, because as soon as you say that, something else comes and tries to tempt you or fill your mind or fill your heart up with nonsense, meaningless nonsense is what like 90% that this world has to offer. Especially with entertainment and everything else. We have to be in the presence of God to grow in our hunger for God. And he said, "Please show me your glory." That sounds like a man who's hungry for God. You know, Lay's potato chips, they had a saying many years ago. I don't know if you remember, but they said, "Bet you can't eat just one." Because they're so good, you just ate the whole bag full. You know, I've been thinking a lot about how God works in the spiritual and in the physical. And over the past several months, you know, I'm trying to really get healthy in multiple ways. And I haven't always been that way. And I'm thinking through about the things I eat, and it's fascinating. One area I'm just really trying to eliminate altogether is sugar. And it's fascinating. Did you know that when you stop eating sugar, your body will actually stop craving sugar? It will stop. But I don't know about you, but for me, as soon as I start to eat sugar again, or chips, or, you know, it's really processed type snack things that aren't good for us. Like when I start that back up, like I got to eat it like every day. It's like I'm craving it, you know, and like I'm going through withdrawals and all this stuff. Why? Because my body's addicted to those things. And I was thinking about that in the spiritual realm. You know, if we are just always hungry and thirsty to be entertained, you know, if we just always have to have some kind of noise on to fill our minds, you know, if we always just have to be in front of a screen, you know, to feel like present or whatever it may be, like something's probably wrong. And we need to unplug and we need to ask ourselves, like, why can't I just be quiet in the presence of God? And I think the reality of it is that we've created a lot of bad habits in our lives, especially in the midst of this pandemic. And we have to take a step back and we have to ask God to give us a hunger and a thirst for him. And so many of us, we say, it's so hard to read the Bible. It's so hard to pray. It's so hard to be engaged in the life of the church. It's so hard. We have to ask ourselves a question. Why? Why is it so hard? Well, one, it's spiritual. Satan wants to keep us from these things. But secondly, it's also on us. We have to also take some ownership for this, church. Because we're creating bad habits. We're not hungering and thirsting for God. You see, but let me ask you this. When you pray with other believers, when you really engage with the body of Christ, you always feel better afterwards, don't you? I know I do. I'll go into a prayer meeting. Oh man, it happened to me a few weeks ago. I didn't want to really pray on a Wednesday night with the church. I was having a rough day, you know, and all these kinds of things. But man, I got on that prayer call and I heard you praying and it just inspired me. It motivated me. And it encouraged my heart and it made me want to hunger more for God. See, but we have to build up our spiritual appetites. That's why it's so important to be in the presence of God every day. God, show me your glory. If that was our heart's cry, how much better off would we be? When we are in the presence of God, we will get to know God intimately. We'll cause others to get to know him, like we see with Joshua. We recognize our helplessness apart from God, and therefore we'll stop trying to do and live our lives apart from God. We will receive direction from God. We'll get answers to prayers in the presence of God, and we will hunger more for God. But we have to build up that spiritual appetite. Stop filling our lives with empty calories of entertainment and false idols. Church, let me ask you a question this morning as we close. Are we getting into the presence of God? Daily, are you searching his word for answers for your life? Daily, are we crying out to him for direction for our lives' problems? Daily, are we worshiping him? Daily, are we hungering more for him? Daily, are we uplifting Fellowship Pickering? Daily, are we seeking the Lord's presence? If the answer is no to those questions, why in the world would we think for 1 minute that we are going to experience the abundant life that Jesus Christ offers? If we are not in the presence of God, why would we think that we are going to have peace instead of anxiety if we're not in the presence of the Prince of Peace? Why would we think that we're going to be filled with faith instead of fear if we aren't in the presence of the one who tells us in Isaiah, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God." We're kidding ourselves. We're actually lying to ourselves. We must get into the presence of God. And this is what I want to say to us today. Spending time with the Lord daily in his presence can no longer be optional. Can no longer be optional. Whatever you have to do, let's get into the presence of God. I want to show you just one more thing before we wrap up this morning. It's all the way back in verse 7. It says, Moses took his tent and he pitched it outside the camp, far from the camp, and he called it the Tabernacle of Meeting. Everyone who sought the Lord went out to the Tabernacle of Meeting, which was outside the camp. See, by making the place of worship outside the camp, Moses clearly drew a line to determine, to see who really wanted to draw close to the Lord, who was actually serious about the presence of God. Sometimes it's not always so easy to get into the presence of God. Sometimes we have to fight, kick, scratch, claw our way into the presence of God. When we're not happy, we must get into the presence of God. When we are happy, we must get into the presence of God. When things are going great, we must get into the presence of God. When the whole world is falling apart all around us, we must get into the presence of God. See, Moses set his tent up where he did because he wanted to see who was serious about getting into the presence of God. Moses says, I'm not gonna make this easy. You're gonna have to journey a little bit to get into the presence of God. And sometimes we have to do the same. This pandemic is causing us to have to battle at times to get into the presence of God, to do things uniquely and differently. But we must engage and get into the presence of God individually and as a church. We say, man, I want to be in the presence of God. Where do I go? What do I do? Do I have to go to a tent? Do I have to go to a tabernacle? Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34 says this. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I'll put my law within them and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me. From the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and I will remember their sin no more. Jesus Christ is the new covenant. We don't have to go into a tent. We don't have to go into a building. You don't have to go to a special place. Jesus is the new covenant. When you ask God to forgive you of your sins, you repent of those sins, you place your faith and trust into Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. He lives inside of us. That His Holy Spirit comes and dwells within us to honor and bring glory to God the Father and God the Son through God the Spirit. This is how we are in the presence of God. Praise Jesus that He is the new covenant. Church, I love you. I thank God for you. And this week and forevermore until Christ comes back, let's get into the presence of God.